Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Corinth Online. My name is Melissa, and I'm so glad to be worshiping with you all this morning. We would love for you to go to live.corinth.cc. That's the best platform to watch our online service this morning. Today, we're going to do a variety of things. We're going to sing songs together. We're going to take communion together, so now would be a great time to gather up those supplies at home if you're going to take communion. And then Adam Turner, our senior minister, is going to continue our series, Habits, where we've been talking about how we can have life-giving habits. And so I'm looking forward to what God's going to do during our service today. Let's jump in.
Good morning. Welcome to Corinth Christian. Let's stand together this morning. Let's give praise to our Savior. Singing with us, you may be seated.
Well, good morning and welcome to Corinth Christian Church. If you came in a little chilly this morning, just remember to be grateful that you live in Georgia and not anywhere further north, okay? We are glad that you have braved the cold to be here this morning and hope that you guys have a great Sunday with us. We're excited to be together and to worship together and want to welcome all of you in the room as well as those who may be joining us online. Want to welcome you and thank you for joining us. We want to invite you to go over to live.corinth.cc. We think that's the best platform for you to engage with us this morning. And so we'll see you there in just a moment. And then I want to welcome anybody in the room here today who may be joining us as a guest, maybe for the first time or the second time or for the first time in a long time. Man, we are honored and grateful that you have decided to come worship with us today. And we hope that you have a great experience. One of the things that we think will help you have a great experience today is if you connect with us. And there's a really great way that we go about doing that every Sunday morning called the Connection Card. It looks just like this card. And it's in the middle of the bulletin you may have grabbed on your way in. And so go ahead and grab that, and we want to invite you to fill out the front side of that card as much as you're comfortable sharing with us. And then after the service, we would love to meet you, greet you, and put a gift in your hand just to say thanks. And so that happens after the service, out these double doors and across the hall at our guest services kiosk. So we'd love to connect with you there. Now, for everybody in the room, I want to invite you to pull out the connection card. It continues to be just a really, really great way to communicate with us. And maybe you can use the connection card today to sign up for an event or to take a next step or to submit a prayer request for our staff to be praying over this week. We love being able to circle up and do that. But then on the back of the card this week, I actually need your help. Now, some of you have tuned into this, but here at Corinth, we've actually got a podcast called Corinth in Your Car. And if you've listened, you know we like to have a little bit of fun on every episode. And so we need your help today. We want you to write in on the back of that connection card some sort of fun question or topic for us to discuss. And make sure you write your name in on it so that we know who is suggesting all these sorts of things. Okay, so do that. Drop it off in the buckets on your way out the door today. Now, a couple of things to let you know about just as far as what's coming up. If you're a middle school or a high school student, or you know a middle school or high school student, one of our biggest events of the year is coming up in just a couple of weeks called Winter Blast. It's February 2nd and 3rd, a Friday night, and an all-day Saturday thing here at the church. And man, we would love to see as many students as we can come out for this. So get signed up for that, or get your student signed up for that, or get your grandson or granddaughter signed up for that so that they don't miss out on a really, really great weekend. Another thing I want to highlight today is just Wednesday nights. Wednesday nights get up and running at the church, and they're super, super great. That's whenever we have youth group for high school students at 6 o'clock. We start serving food, and 6:30 we start a service. But then actually at 6:30 we have a class that I think will be really, really helpful for you. We just started it up, and it's called Intro to the Gospels. Wednesday night, it's in Founders Hall. We would love to see you there. You can sign up on the Church Center app. Join us on Wednesday nights. It'd be a great habit for you to get into for that. Now, here's the cheesy transition. Speaking of habits, that's the sermon series that we are in right now. We're continuing that one today with part number two. Our senior minister's got some really good stuff to share. I'm ready to get into this and excited to worship with you guys this morning. And so let's just pray, and then we'll stand and sing together. God, we are grateful for your grace and for your love, for your faithfulness that you have displayed again and again and again. And it's so exciting. It's such an honor to come together with other people who believe the same things and just to give you praise, to give you glory. And so we pray that that would take place today, and that as that takes place, that you would do a transforming work in our heart. Father, I pray that today you would provide for us. Some in the room are in need of some comfort. So we pray that by your work, they would find it today. Some, Father, today are in need of a challenge. And so I pray today that by your work, they would find that challenge and that we would all leave here ready to take next steps of growth as we follow you always. We pray that you would be with us today. In Jesus' name.
Confession.
guys can have a seat. This last weekend, my wife and I were able to get away out to Colorado Springs, Colorado. The reason for the trip was one of my best friends from college was getting married, and I guess that's a good enough excuse as any to go to Colorado, so it was pretty awesome. Really, really great time reconnecting with friends, enjoying good food, throwing snowballs at just about everybody. And I was kind of annoying everybody because everybody else in the groups, like, they grew up in the wintery areas. And I'm like, bro, I'm from Georgia. If I get a chance to throw a snowball at you, I'm going to do just that. And so it was just a really, really great time. But by far, the highlight of every single time I get to go out that way is just the scenery. Man, and if you've been out that way, you know just how beautiful it really is. The city of Colorado Springs kind of sits on the edge of an area where the Rockies start, and it features just this incredible sky view of the mountains featuring Pikes Peak at 14,114 feet elevation. And so you're there, and you're just like, your eyes just can't not look at the beautiful landscape around. And it was just cool to be there, and it reminded me of a verse, Isaiah chapter 54, verse 10. I want to read that for you. Here's what God is saying through the prophet Isaiah here. He says, "For the mountains may move and the hills disappear, but even then, my faithful love for you will remain. My covenant of blessing will never be broken, says the Lord, who has mercy on you." And it's just got me thinking, like, as big and as impressive and as beautiful as the mountains are, they may change. And really, they only exist to give God glory. But God promises here in Isaiah chapter 54, one thing will not change. I will keep my covenant. You fast forward from Isaiah 54 to Mark chapter 14. Jesus is sitting around a table with his disciples, and they're sharing the Passover meal when all of a sudden he takes some of the bread and he passes it around to them and encourages them to eat and says, "This is my body." And when they're finished with that, he takes the cup and he passes it around and encourages them to drink, and he says, "This is my blood, which is the covenant." And all of a sudden you see Isaiah chapter 54, God says, "I will keep my covenant." You see that being fulfilled in the work of Jesus the night before he goes to the cross and dies for our sins so that we can experience relationship with him. So this has got me thinking just simply this: praise God that he is faithful to keep his promises. Praise God that he stayed faithful to the covenant that he made to us. And praise God that we can experience relationship with him because of that. And so I want to encourage you to think through these things as we share this meal together, proclaiming Jesus' death and resurrection through this meal. Let's take out the bread and let's eat together, remembering that this is Jesus' body. And then just like they did that night, the cup we'll take and we'll drink, remembering that this is Jesus' blood. And so, Father, today we just simply cry out with gratitude, saying thank you for keeping your promises. Thank you for being faithful, and thank you for inviting us into this covenant relationship with you because of what your Son did on the cross. We look to that now in faith, asking that you would transform us. In Jesus' name.
Father God, we are overwhelmed with gratitude this morning, as always. So many things to be thankful for. The fact that we are able to be here in this place, singing songs to you, a reason to be grateful. The fact that you have loved us enough, that you have given us your scriptures so that we could be able to search them out and find you, to begin to discover your heart, your plan, your desires for our lives. The fact that whatever storm, valley, shadow that we've been walking through this week, that we know that there is nothing that has happened to us that hasn't passed through your hand, that you are a God who is able to work out all things for the good of those who love you and who have been called according to your purpose. And so our hearts are filled with gratitude today. Help us to fix our eyes on Jesus this morning and give us the desire to become more like him. And we pray this in his name, and we say amen and amen. Well, friends, it is fantastic to see you here this morning. Thanks for coming out today. Thanks for watching online as well, whether that's YouTube, Facebook, Church Online, wherever you find yourself. Thanks for tuning in. If you're in the room real quick, let's give them a howdy to our online friends. You guys ready? One, two, three. Howdy. We hope to see you in person. We'd love to see you here next week in person. Think it'd be a great Sunday for you to be here in the room. We'd love to see your smiling face. But if you're online, be sure to like and share, send some text messages, invite some folks to watch along with you, and then be active participants in the chat this morning as things are going along. And thank you for your giving, both online and in the room, and however you do that, whether envelopes, USPS, online, thank you so, so very much for your continued generosity. Before we start, real quick, just turn to your neighbor and say, Saban finally retired. Come on now, come on now, come on. He finally gone. He's out. He's gone. All right. That's fantastic. Hey, let me ask you a question. And for some of you, this may not be a fair question, but if I were to ask you, what did you do Wednesday morning? I just want you to think back. What did Wednesday morning look like? How did it go? What did you do? You know, from the wake up to the go to, you know, get to work or school or wherever it was. What did you do Wednesday morning? And for some of you, as you're sitting here, you're racking your brain, you're thinking about it. You don't know the answer, okay? You just really don't know. And so I'm going to give you the answer. You guys ready for it? It's probably what you did Tuesday morning, all right? And so whenever you did Tuesday morning is what you did Wednesday morning, which is what you did Thursday morning, because that's just what we tend to do. You know, we wake up, we get up, we go to the bathroom, you know, we check our phone, maybe you go to Instagram, your email, text messages, Facebook, Twitter, check the news, you go into the kitchen, you know, you drink some water, you make your coffee, you let the dogs out, the dogs in, the cats you don't care about, and so you just kind of start going through it. You know, you eat your breakfast, you do all the things, you get cleaned up, and then you get up and you go to work, you go to school, and you do this every single day. And what happens is like you get to work and you're like, what did I do this morning? You know, it's like I was just like on autopilot today. I don't even have a clue what took place. And there is a reason for this, and it's actually God's blessing for us, is that God has designed our brains to create habits. In fact, there was this Duke study that was done in 2006, which is way too long ago now. But in 2006, and they found that 40% of everything that we do is based not on choices, but on habits. Because there are so many choices that you and I have to make every single day that if we had to make 100% of our decisions based off of choices, our brains would melt out of our ears and we would just have smoke coming out of our ears that all the time because there's just so much going on. So God in his mercy, God in his grace designed you and me and our brains to just fall into these habits that will allow us to just go on in life. And what that means is so important. It's stupid simple, but it's really important. It's this, that if you want to change your life, then that means you're going to have to change your habits. If you really want to change your life, if you want to experience life change, then that means you're going to have to change your habits and the things that you do every single day. And so that's why last week we started a brand new sermon series. We're starting off the year 2024 with a sermon series called Habits, Small Disciplines, Big Results. And in these first 4 weeks of the year, we are laying out the groundwork so that you and I, we can have a different year in 2024 than we had in 2023.
23, maybe in 22, maybe in 21, maybe in 2020, because we're going to talk about how we can just create these new systems, these new habits in our lives that'll help lead to life change for you and for me. And so last week, introduced to y'all a few resources, The Power of Habit by Charles Duhigg, Atomic Habits by James Clear, and The Power to Change, my favorite book on the subject, by Pastor Craig Groeschel. Those are incredible things, and I'm throwing this up here again, not just so that you'll know the books to buy or anything like that, but so that if you end up buying them and reading them and you're like, didn't Adam say that? Yes, he did. Okay, and that's where it came from, all right? So just letting y'all know that. But last week, we talked about why we generally fail. This is one of those series, if you're watching online or if you're in the room for the first time and you missed last week, this is one of those series that I would really, really encourage you to go back and get on the Corinth.cc thing and watch week one of this series because they all kind of build on each other. But last week, we talked about why we generally fail whenever it comes to setting out new goals and new habits because we focus on outcomes and not progress. Results don't come quick enough for us. We focus more on what we're going to do than who we're going to become. And basically, the big idea of the message last week would just be this. We make a faulty conclusion that small decisions, whether they're good or bad, don't matter very much, and we fail to realize that our life is the sum total of all the small decisions that we make. And we introduced this quote to you from James Clear where he said, you don't rise to the level of your goals, but you fall to the level of your systems. In other words, the habits and the systems that you have in your life are perfectly designed to give you the results that you are currently achieving. So think about that. Everything that you are achieving in life right now, it is because of the habits and the systems that you have in your life. You're like, well, I don't like it. Well, that's good. That's because you may not have the right systems in place. So today, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about how do I start a new habit? How do I begin a new cycle? How do I begin a new system in my life? And to do that, I want to give you a powerful example from the Old Testament. If you got a Bible, I'd invite you to find the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 6 specifically is where we're going to be here in just a moment. But Daniel is one of those books that if you grew up and you didn't really go to church, but you went to a VBS or a Sunday school or a church camp because your grandma, you know, told you she'd pay for it if you did, you know, then you've probably heard of the book of Daniel. This is the story where, you know, you've got Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the furnace of fire. It's Daniel's in the lion's den, all kinds of great things. But the way the story really begins, it's about the year 587 BC, and King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, they conquer Jerusalem, and they go in, and they just wipe the place out. I mean, they burn the temple down. They're murdering countless number of people, and they're just, it's a hostile takeover of the Jewish people. And what Nebuchadnezzar does is he decides that he wants to find the young and the those with great potential. We would call it the 30 under 30, but there was more than 30, but that's what we're talking about. We're talking about young guys that have all kinds of potential, and he says, I want to bring them in, and I want to indoctrinate them into the ways of Babylon. And the reason he wanted to do this is he's trying to get all of the Hebrew out of them and get the Babylonian way of living into them. Because then these young men who are going to be successful leaders, if I can get them, this is Nebuchadnezzar's train of thought, if I can get them to act like Babylonians, then they will lead the people around them to act like Babylonians. It'll make our occupation, it'll make everything go a whole lot easier for us if they think this way. And so this is what's going on. And it comes along that Daniel and his buddies, they don't go along with the Babylonian ways, all right? And they stand firm. They stay tall in it. And what ends up happening early in the book of Daniel is Nebuchadnezzar has a dream. It's a crazy dream. Nobody can answer it. Nobody has a clue what is going on. He won't even tell them what the dream is. He's like, no, if you're going to tell me what it is, you got to tell me what the dream is as well so I actually know that you know what you're talking about. And eventually, Daniel is the one who is able to interpret the dream. And this causes this foreign Babylonian king to look at Daniel, to bow down and to present an offering to Daniel's God, the God of the Hebrews, the God of the Bible, and say that surely your God is the one true God. It's amazing. Amazing. Well, Daniel chapter 6 is years later. In the beginning of the book, Daniel's a young guy. Now, when we get to chapter 6, he's older, okay? He's in his 80s at this point. And there have been two other kings. Nebuchadnezzar gave way to Belshazzar, and then it's actually a new nation. It's the Medes, and you can call him Darius or Darius, depending on how pretentious you want to be. So Darius, he was leading the Medo-Persians. He is now the king. And once again, Daniel finds favor with this king. Listen to verse 3. It says, Daniel soon proved himself more capable than all the other administrators and high officers. Because of Daniel's great ability, the king made plans to place him over the entire empire. In other words, there's this planned promotion that's in place for Daniel. This 80-year-old guy, they're looking at him, they're like, dude, there's nobody better than this guy. And this makes the key leaders in Darius's court jealous. And so they devise a plan to take Daniel out. And as they're looking into Daniel's life, you know, they're reading his emails, reading his text messages. They're like snooping and, you know, all these things are going on. They can't find any weakness in this guy. And there's like no vulnerability. And so they come to this conclusion. You can see it in verse 5. It says, our only chance of finding grounds for accusing Daniel will be in connection with the rules of his religion. The only way we're going to be able to get this Daniel guy to go sideways from us is if we make a new rule that goes against his faith. Because this is a faithful guy. He's always going to stay true to what his faith wants him to do. And so they go to Darius and they pressure him and they say, we need to make a law. You know, king, there's nobody like you on the face of this earth. And so how about this? If anyone prays to any god other than you in the next 30 days, we should just throw them into the lion's den and let them be eaten up. And Darius is, you know, he's got an ego. He's like, that sounds like a great idea. And so he puts that into place. And this is where we get to see the one habit that made Daniel who Daniel was. Watch for it. It's in verse 10. It says, but when Daniel learned that the law had been signed, he went home, and say this next phrase with me. He went home and he did what? He knelt down as usual in his upstairs room. With its windows open toward Jerusalem, he prayed three times a day, just as he had always done, giving thanks to his God. Everybody knows Daniel because he is able to go into the lion's den and he comes out fine. But how did Daniel set himself apart? What is it that made Daniel different than everybody else? I would say it all starts with the one habit that he had. It's a small habit, but three times a day he prayed just as he always had done before. And that habit of prayer is what allowed Daniel to develop intimacy with God, gave him the courage to obey, that allowed him to stand tall when others would fall. Now, here's what I want you to see. Never underestimate how God can start something big through one small habit. Don't underestimate it. Because successful people do consistently what others do occasionally. So here's the question that we're going to spend the rest of our time wrestling with today. And it's this. Based on who you want to become, what's one habit you need to start? As remember, we're going to focus on who before do. So who do we want to become? That's what we talked about last week. So this week, what's one habit that you need to start? It doesn't have to be a big habit. In fact, generally what they say, habitologists will say, it's better if they are small. And it can be something as small as like, you know what? I want to become someone who doesn't hit the snooze button. I want to become somebody who reads their Bible before he checks his phone. I want to be somebody who gets up 15 minutes earlier. Who do you want to become? You know, do you want to become someone who is more caring for other people? Well, then what's one small habit you could start? Maybe you're going to write one note of appreciation every single day. Send it out. You know, maybe you want to become someone who's organized. What's one small thing that you can do? Well, your mama was right. It's make your bed every single morning. You know, you want to become someone who's a godly example, you know, to your kids or to your grandkids. Maybe you initiate reading a Bible plan together and working through that with each other. Maybe you want to become someone who's focus. And so you're going to write down your big three every single day, or here are the things I need to get done today. Maybe you want to become somebody who's healthy. And so it's no more soda, no more candy, no more pie, no more ice cream, no more joy, you know, nothing, you know, all those things. Who do you want to become though? That's the question. And here's the thing. This isn't in your notes, but you might want to scribble this down. Hope will get you started. Habits will get you going. So the hope of becoming somebody new is what will get you started, but habits is what's going to make it actually get going and allowing you and I to see progress. So how do we create a new habit? Let's answer that question. How do we create a new habit? How do you create a system? And you may be watching online, even sitting in the room, and you're just like, I don't have a system. And you know, and the answer is, well, yes, you do. Okay? Everybody has a system. It may not be a good system, but every single one of us has a system. You may have we're going to wake up late, yell at the kids to get going, eat breakfast in the car, and arrive at church angry system. Okay? That is a system. It's not a good system, but it is a system that is there. And you may not have intentionally created the system, but you do, by default, have systems, every single one of us. So I love what John Maxwell says. He says, people have uphill hopes and downhill habits. We all want what's up there because we all know that everything worth having is uphill, but the habits that we have are downhill. What we want to do is create uphill habits. And so let's ask this question. So how do habits get created in the first place? And what people who study this say, there's really this kind of a three-step loop. There's a cue, a response, and a reward. But I like what James Clear does in Atomic Habits. He actually adds a fourth step in there, and this is in your notes, and you can see it. And there's a cue, a craving, a response, and a reward. So the cue is this trigger that alerts our brain it's time to go into autopilot. The craving is that physical or mental or emotional need that the cue leads you to want to satisfy. The response is the behavior that you routinely fall into. And the reward is how the behavior makes you feel. And here's what happens. If the behavior creates pleasure, here's what your wonderful brain does. It decides, hey, that is a loop worth remembering. And so the next time that cue appears, your brain jumps in and says, hey, I know something that we could do that would feel good. Okay? And you do that enough, and a habit becomes the process. It just becomes automatic. And that cue creates the anticipation, and the reward becomes intertwined, and a habit is born. Let me give you some examples. These are some bad examples. So let's say you had a hard day at work, a rough day. Maybe arguments, stress, all things going on. Just a difficult day at work. And so your craving is that you want stress relief. And your response is, well, I'm just going to drink alcohol to numb it. And the reward is that you get to escape thinking about your boss or your employees for a little bit. The cue is that you're bored. And so your craving is, well, I want to be entertained for a little bit. So your response is, let me grab my phone and check social media and scroll through here and see some crazy, you know, TikTok videos or Instagram reels or those things. And the reward is a dopamine rush that feels good. The cue is you're driving down the highway and the Krispy Kreme hot light is on. The craving is for hot, deep-fried sugar dough. The response is you pull in and you buy a dozen, eat six of them immediately, and the reward is a dopamine rush that feels good for 20 minutes, okay? So that's how this works. We're talking cue, craving, response, reward, and you do it enough, it just becomes automatic. That's why you find yourself in the Krispy Kreme drive-thru, and you're like, how did I get here? It's like, oh, the red light was on, okay? That's why I'm here, okay? So the question is, how do you create new positive habits that will help you become who you want to become? And the strategy is actually very, very simple. We're going to make it obvious, we're going to make it easy, and we're going to make it communal. Let's talk about each one of those. We're going to have to make it obvious. When it comes to your habits, here's just kind of the phrase to remember, your cues determine what you do. And so if you want to change what you do, change your cue. Okay? That's just the kind of way to write. If you want to change what you do, change your cue. And so what we do is we want to make the cue obvious. Let's say you want to be someone who wants to start getting healthier, so you want to start taking vitamins or supplements. Well, the answer is you've got to make that obvious to yourself at the beginning. And so you don't put them in the cabinet. You don't put them in the drawer. You set them on the cabinet no matter what your wife says, and you put them right there so that whenever you see them first thing in the morning, you go, oh, that's the cue. I need to take my vitamins. Let's say that you want to, read your Bible in the morning. And you're like, this is what I want to do. I want to be somebody who reads my Bible in the morning. And so instead of taking your Bible and putting it in a drawer or in a room that you're not going to walk into in the morning, you want to make it obvious. And so it's either right there on your nightstand, or maybe it's there in your bathroom next to your toothbrush. One guy I know, he puts it next to his coffee pot because he knows that he's going to make coffee every single morning, but you make it obvious so that you are grabbing it first thing whenever you see it. If you want to be somebody who's drinking more water, then what you do is you grab that big Stanley cup that you got in a fist fight at Target, and you grab that and you set it out every single morning. Maybe you preload it the night before so that you see it first thing in the morning so that you're like, oh, I need to drink more water. What are we doing? We're trying to eliminate friction. We're trying to make it obvious to us. And you sit there and you say, well, like, all those steps, that sounds like super obvious, like things that we should do. But here's the deal. Most people don't do them. They don't. And what we've got to remember is, and I love what James Clear says, he says, you don't have to be the victim of your environment. You can be the architect of it. So what are we going to do? We're going to make it obvious. Here's the second thing. We're going to make it easy. We're going to eliminate friction that makes it difficult for us to get the thing that we want to get to. And there's a great book. It's an older book now. It's been around forever. It's Getting Things Done by David Allen. It's a productivity system. And in that, he's got this thing that he calls the two-minute rule. And the basic idea is that whenever you're rolling through the things that you need to get done in your day, and you look at it and you look at your list, if it's something that takes 2 minutes or less and it's something that you actually want to do, then you do it right then instead of like, oh, I need to create a list. It's like, I need to put the milk in the fridge. Well, let me write down the 9 steps that I need to do. It's like, no, just grab it, put it in the fridge because it takes less than 2 minutes to do. Well, whenever it comes to habits, the same thing is true. That if you're wanting to create something new in your life and create a new system of behavior, it should take less than 2 minutes to do to get it going. So here's what it means. If you want to start journaling, like this is what I want to do. I hear people talk about it. I want to be more reflective. So I'm going to start journaling. Well, then here's what your goal is. Your goal is at the very beginning is to write 1 sentence a day. Just 1 sentence. And you just get that done. You want to start reading before bed? Instead of saying, I want to read 30 minutes before I fall asleep, just say, you know what? I'm going to read 1 page before I go to bed. Okay, that's what I'm going to do. You want to start running? You don't go, you know, I'm going to start running 5 miles a day. I'm going to do that, you know, because you'll be dead and bad knees. Okay, that's not what you do. But you say, I'm going to run for 2 minutes every day. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to run for 2 minutes. You want to pray with your spouse because, you know, you're like, I don't know what to do because it can be weird. It can be awkward. Never done it before. Where do we start? Here's where you start. Start by holding hands and thanking God for one thing he did that day. And that's where you begin. If you want to start exercising, you know, getting in shape, there's so many questions like, what program do I need to follow? What gym do I need to join? What kind of equipment do I need? It's like, no, we're going to make it simpler. We're going to make it easy. You just start off and say, you know what, I'm going to do 5 push-ups a day. And just start off there. And here's why. This is why this is so important. Once you start doing the right thing, it's easier to continue doing the right thing. The hard part is the start. And if you make your habit difficult to begin, you probably will never begin it. If you start off saying, you know what, I'm gonna read for 45 minutes every single day and you haven't read a book since junior year of high school, you're probably not gonna make it. But if you can say, you know what, I'm gonna read a page, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that, you make it easy, you just do that one point. The point is this, that you start. Remember Zechariah 4:10, it says this, do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin. That's what we want. We just want the work to begin. Now, one way to make it easy is something that they call habit stacking. And habit stacking is basically this, I will do blank after I blank. Daniel is a great example of this. Daniel prayed 3 times a day. Do you want to know what else he probably did 3 times a day? He ate. And so this is what Daniel did. I will pray after I eat. I'm going to have my breakfast. I'm going to pray. Going to eat my lunch. I'm going to pray. Going to have my dinner. I'm going to pray. And he took those and he took that habit that was already there. Everybody's going to eat. And he took that habit and he added the prayer routine into it. And so remember, we've already got habits and routines and systems. The question is, how can we leverage the systems that we currently have to add the behaviors that we desire? Like for me, I have a morning routine that happens almost every single day. I wake up, okay? I drink 20 ounces of water. I let the dogs outside. I put food in the dog bowl, water in the dog bowls, okay? I start the coffee. I let the dogs in. I give them their treats because they're like crackheads with those things, you know? And it's just like, there, just get it, get out of the way, okay? I drink my greens while the coffee is brewing. I do those things, and then I'll either eat breakfast, might not eat breakfast that day, and then the coffee will be ready, and then I'll get my coffee. I'll go sit down at my desk in my own office, and then it's time to journal. I write down what happened yesterday, how I'm feeling in the moment. I do my grateful for, my prayer for, what I'm going to read that day. Then I do my Bible reading, and then I do my devotional readings from My Utmost for His Highest, New Morning Mercies, and Proverbs with Tim Keller, and then I spend time in quiet, and then I clean up, and then I either come into the office, or I go back to the home office desk, and I sit down and I write. This is what I do every single day. And so what I've done too, which is just another step, is I actually know how many minutes each one of those things takes for me in my routine. And so I know if I want to be at X place by this time o'clock, then that means I've got to be up by this time o'clock, okay? And that's how it works. Now, here's the thing. All of my devotional rhythms happen in the flow of things that I already do every day. And here's what I know, because I know myself pretty well. If I don't do it in that morning routine, it doesn't happen. It just doesn't happen. I'm not going to do it in the evening, I can just tell you. But if I get it into that flow of my morning, of things that I'm already doing, just stacking it into those habits, it just becomes a part of who I am. And so you can do the same thing. You can say, okay, what do I want to do? Well, after I put the kids to bed, I'm going to do 5 push-ups. And after I do 5 push-ups, I'm going to journal 1 sentence. And after I journal 1 sentence, I'm going to hold my wife's hand and I'm going to thank God for 1 thing. You just start adding those things in. You make it obvious. You make it easy. Here's the third thing, is you make it communal. And the secret is that you don't want to try to do these things by yourself. What you want to do is surround yourself with like-minded people who already do what you want to do. Maybe you've heard this before, but you become the average of your 5 closest friends. Maybe you've heard this before. You know, we start to eat what they eat. We talk like they talk. We end up dressing like they dress. We end up with the same hobbies that they have. We think like they think, read what they read, watch what they watch. We become the average of our 5 closest friends. And really, that's a biblical principle that Solomon, the wisest man to ever walk the face of the earth, not named Jesus, he says it like this in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20, when he said, "Walk with the wise and become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harms." So what that means is, and so everybody needs to listen up, your mama and your grandmama were right. You become like who you run with. Birds of a feather flock together, okay? So your mama was right. This is what takes place. In fact, one study showed that a person's chances of becoming obese increased by 57% if he or she had 1 obese friend. And another study found that if one person in a relationship loses weight, the partner would also slim down about 1/3 of the time. See, this is why things like Weight Watchers and 12-step programs work so well. It's not just about the habits that they are building into your life. It's about the community, being around like-minded people. So how do you make a habit stick? Well, you join a community where your desired goal and your desired behavior is the normal behavior. You surround yourself with people who have the habits you want to have yourself. So men, listen to me. If you want to be a man who loves Jesus, loves his church, loves his wife, is a good dad, is sharp mentally and physically, is wise financially and generous, then you need to look at your 5 closest friends and say, are they doing those things? Because they will make it easier to live out that life. But if you flip it, and if those things are your goals, and the people you're hanging around are unemployed, directionalists, drink a lot, smoke a lot, don't believe in God, think prayer is stupid, never get off the couch, and couldn't find their Bible if you gave them $50, it's going to be really difficult to become the person that you want to be. I love what Groeschel says. He says this, living the right life is almost impossible if you have the wrong friends. Now, here's the good news. This is what the studies show. It only really takes one friend, starting to hang around one person that's got the desired goals and desired behavior that you want to have. You don't have to have 5. If you just have 1, the change can take place. So how do you create a new habit? You make it obvious, you make it easy, and you make it communal. Who do you hope to become, and what habit do you need to start? And I gotta tell you guys, so over the next couple more weeks, this is something I'm pretty passionate about. And I think you'll probably get an idea of that by how long the messages are. And the reason this is so deeply personal to me is that it was a few years ago, it was probably 5, 6, 7 years ago, that I knew who I wanted to become, but I also knew that my systems and my habits were perfectly designed for the results I was achieving, and I wasn't happy with it. I mean, I was looking at my life, and I knew where I wanted to go. I knew who I was wanting to become, and I was looking at my habits, looking at my rhythms, and I was just like, man, this is not where it is. You know, like, I'm embarrassed to tell you this, but, like, I read the Bible only to preach from it. You know, it's just like I was just reading it so I'd be able to find sermons, or my devotional life was a mess. It was just so inconsistent. In some ways, I would describe myself as like a spiritual binge eater. It's like where I would like just like go like all in. It's like I want to read the entire Bible in 90 days, and then I would do it, but then I wouldn't touch it again for months on end, and had no just prayer life, all these kind of things. It's honestly, it's embarrassing. It really, really is. And so I looked at my life. It's like I'm spiritually in shape, but I'm physically in shape, but I'm spiritually flabby. And it was frustrating, so frustrating. And so I had to start off with just a super small initial commitment. It was like, I'm going to make a difference. I'm going to make a change. I'm going to start a new system. And so this is what I started with. I'm going to read one chapter of Proverbs every single day. So pathetic. For me, you know, I'm just sitting there, it's like, I was just kind of embarrassed. It's just like, oh my gosh, I can't believe it. But then that habit started small, 5 minutes or less a day. And then it's like, okay, so now what else can we start to add on? So then we started adding on things like, you know, journaling. Then we started adding on things like, you know, the gratitude, the grateful fours, the prayer list. Started adding in devotional readings. Then started adding in, it's like, you know what? I can probably read more than Proverbs every single day. And so it's like, let's start working through the Bible every single year. And then it's like, you know what I'd love to do? I want to read the book. I want to read Psalms 4 times a year and just create a system to do that. And, you know, start praying with my wife, you know, the tithing and all the other kind of things that are just kind of there. So it's like all these habits and just started stacking and stacking and stacking and stacking. And the reason I care about this so much is I know the difference it made in my life. And I know the difference it will make in your life if you'll just let one small habit start to stack and to build and to build and to build into things in your life. And you will experience the big results that God has for you. Now, I'll let you know. Not everything is stuck throughout the years, okay? Like, I remember 1 year, I don't have a whole lot of time, but anyway, 1 year, I found this one thing. I was like, man, this sounds so cool. It's like a 5-year journal. And it's like you're supposed to write down just like a couple of sentences every single day. And then like it was, you know, like Monday, January 1st, you know, 2019. And then the next line was January, you know, 1st, 2020, 2021. You know what I'm saying? So this would be 5 years. And so you would just, the idea is that you write a sentence down. And then the next year you write a sentence down. The next year you write a sentence down. And then at the end of the 5 years, you're like, oh, wow, this is amazing, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I was just like, I got about 6 weeks and I was like, this is about the dumbest thing that I've ever tried to do. You know, I'm already journaling. I'm already capturing all these kinds of things. Why am I doing this thing twice? This is stupid. So there's like a 5-year journal that has like 6 weeks of entries that is sitting over in a corner in my room. My kids will find it in 30 years and they'll be like, well, that was weird. You know, it's like, what was he doing here? And so not everything sticks, but the point is that you find what works for you and you just start to just build these things. And so that's why here's your bottom line. Don't underestimate how God can do something big through a small habit. For Daniel, it was the small habit of, I'm just going to pray after I eat. And that allowed him to stand tall when others just fell away. For you, it may be just the small habit of just like, you know what? I'm going to read my Bible every single day, just 2 minutes a day, and start off with the book of Proverbs and just read one chapter every single day, and you allow that to start building up. Maybe it's going to be reflective, and you're going to say, oh, I'm going to write down one thing I'm grateful for every single day, and then it's going to build into other things, and you just start working through these things. But don't underestimate how God can do something big through a small habit. Because here's my challenge to you this week is this. So based on who you want to become, what's the one habit you need to start? Just one. We're starting small. We're going to make it easy. We're going to make it obvious. And we're going to make it communal. And you write. And here's the thing. I want you to write it down. Okay, last week you wrote down who you wanted to become. This week, write down what's the habit that you need to start to help you become who you need to become. And I want to remind you of all of this. Now remember, we're getting here to week 4. But the point of this is not behavior modification. That's not what we're talking about. What we want is not just to see behavior change. We want you to experience spiritual transformation. And that begins whenever you do one small step of surrender, and you surrender everything. Whenever you make Jesus Lord of your life, and you say, God, I want you to be my Lord, my King, my Savior, you know what you're saying? Is I want you to be Lord of my systems as well. Everything gets laid down before your feet, Jesus. My habits, my systems, my routines, everything. And Jesus, I want you to take those, redeem them, and help me become the person that you've created me to be. But that all begins with the one small step of surrender to where you say, Jesus, I want you to be Lord of my life. And if you've never done that, and you're watching online or you're in the room and you are ready to make a decision to follow Jesus Christ, online, visit the website that's on the screen. In the room, grab that connection card and say, I'm ready to begin a relationship with Jesus. And let's begin your new journey to becoming the person God created you to be. Father God, we love you so much, and we thank you that you have created these systems, designed these things, so that we can become the people you want us to be. And God, I know that we threw out a lot of information today, and the fire hose has been on, and I'm praying that you will help us to soak in what needs to be soaked in, and that we would allow it to marinate and to permeate our souls. And that just one small thing can be different because we were here today. One small habit can be started that would be transformational in our lives as we continue our walk with you. And we pray this in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen and amen. Love y'all.
Thank you so much for joining us at Corinth Online today. We hope that you enjoyed our service. And if you have any questions about our church, I encourage you to go to our church website, corinth.cc. There you can find out all kinds of information about upcoming events, weekly programs that we have here at the church. Basically, anything you need to know, you can find at that website. We hope to see you here online again next week or in person sometime soon. Have a great week.